Thankful that you are here. You could be anywhere, but I'm thankful you're here. Just to remind you that next Sunday evening, Bible school begins, and in your bulletin again this morning is the prayer card for Bible school. And just if you've got two of them now from the last two Sundays, then that's a good thing. Pray twice as much, pray twice as hard, whatever, but some good ideas for praying on here for Bible school, so I hope you'll be taking advantage of that and in your time of prayer each day that you'll be using that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise for who you are. Lord, you are worthy of everything. You're worthy of our service, you're worthy of our devotion, you're worthy of our worship. You're worthy of our lives totally committed to you. Amen. And Father, we thank you, we praise you, that you love us enough that Jesus Christ, your Son, came to earth, willingly came to earth, took on flesh, died in our place, and rose from the dead. Father, we thank you, we praise you, and you are worthy of our worship. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. We're going to start off our worship service this morning with hymn number 249, Jesus Paid It All. If you'd please stand and let's worship together.
Enjoy your first week out of school, did you? I bet you did. I bet you did. I want to talk to you about, this is a man named Paul. This is a picture of a man named Paul. Now, Paul was in prison when he wrote a letter to his friend Timothy. This letter was the last letter that Paul wrote to his friend. And in the letter, Paul thanked Timothy. And Paul told Timothy that he prayed for him every night and every day. He remembered how Timothy had first lived with his grandma and Lois and his mother, his mama Eunice, how they taught him about God and having faith in him. Paul knew that Timothy's faith was real and genuine. He encouraged Timothy. He wanted him to keep learning and believing in Jesus. He reminded Timothy that he had grown up with the Bible, the scriptures they had when he was a child, and that he needed to learn and grow some more. Paul explained to Timothy that all the scriptures came from God. And Paul shared that the scriptures, the Bible, teach us what is right and what is good, what's right and what's wrong. Paul explained he could use the scriptures to correct bad behavior and to show us how to obey God. You see, Paul encouraged Timothy to study the scriptures because they would help him do all that God wanted him to be. Now, I want to point out a couple of things here on this picture. If you want to read, you read out of a book, don't you? You know what this is? This is a scroll, isn't it? And this is where he would write things, and they wind it up on the scroll. Now, if we want to see when it's dark, what do? We turn on a light. They didn't have lights, didn't have electricity. Look at that little candle burning, that little light burning so he could see. Isn't that interesting? This was probably a water jar, so if he got thirsty, he had water. If we want water, we just go to the kitchen and get water, don't we? So this is some of the things that we see here. But Paul wrote Timothy to encourage him, because Timothy was a young man. He loved God, and he was doing what God wanted him to do. Paul wanted him to help him do what God wanted him to do. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you and praise you so much for this day you've given us. Father, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for telling us how much you love us in the Bible. And Lord, help us to read our Bible so we can know more about you and know you more. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right.
Now we're going to have our offertory hymn number 361. We have heard the joyful sound. If you'll please stand.
Jesus. thank you for this day and every day of life you give us, Lord, to serve you. I ask, Father, that you will bless the services today. Lord, the singing, the preaching, and everything that goes on from high, let your Holy Spirit have free reign here today, Lord, that we may learn more about you and serve you like you have called us. I ask for your blessings on the giver and what the money goes for. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Treat this morning you are the choir, you are the special music. We need more people in the choir, y'all, so I figured this would be a good opportunity to give y'all a trial run, a test run, if you will. Look at your neighbor and say hello, choir member. For real. All right, we're gonna sing our special all together, all in one accord. I know that we all know this song. So if you would please stand and let's sing hymn number 6, How Great Thou Art.
I see.
turn.
That's right. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Have your Bibles turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 13. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 13. You know, the Christian life is not a sprint. It's a long distance race. And as a runner, I can tell you that it's easy to start a long distance race, but sometimes it's difficult to finish one. The longest races I have run are half marathons, and if you're wondering, that's 13.1 miles. Do not tell a runner it's only 13 miles. It's 13.1 miles. Don't leave off that .1. We earn that when we run that. The runners agree with that. Those who run agree with that. You want that 13.1. That's the longest race I've run, and unless I lose my mind, that's the longest one I'll ever run. I started every one of them. I think I ended up running 8 of them. I started every one of them with this great enthusiasm that I was going to run that race faster than any other half marathon I had run before. I did that one time by a few seconds. After that, I thought, well, I can beat that time. And I started off with great enthusiasm that I was going to beat. I never thought about beating other people because that was kind of crazy. I always wanted to beat my time from the previous one. Well, as I have gotten older, that became an impossibility for me anyway. And I remember the last couple that I ran, there were times that I wanted to just give up. One was over, it's called the Palomino Peach. You start in North Augusta over near the baseball stadium, the Green Jacket Stadium, and wind your way up the Greenway, and then you come out onto Martintown Road. If you know anything about Martintown Road, there near Victory Baptist Church, there is this humongous hill. For a runner, that hill is 152 miles long, or so it seems. The first time I ran that race, and here's how crazy your pastor is, I've run that particular race 3 times. And 3 is a good number, so I'm going to stop at that one. The first time I ran it, I said, I'm going to see if I can run Mountaintown Road. So about 2/3 up the way of it, my leg said, you're done. We rebel. So I walked the rest of the way up that hill. But there comes a point. My point is this. There comes a point, the longer the race that I've run, there comes a point you just wonder if it's worth getting to the finish line. But in every long distance race I've run, I've made it to the finish line. Sometimes strong, sometimes weak. Sometimes wondering what I had done to my body, but I made it to the finish line. What do? You dig deep. You say, I'm going to finish. I'm going to endure. I'm going to run. I'm going to endure to the finish line. So when applied to the Christian life, we have to ask the question, will I be faithful to the Lord to the finish line of my life? Or will I give up? Will I quit serving Him? Will I quit being as faithful to Him as I once was? Will I have the attitude, well, I'm older, I've served my time, let somebody else do it? Or do we want to be able to say at the end of our life, as the Apostle Paul said later in this book, verse chapter 4, verse 7, Paul said, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. The older I get, the more that verse means so much to me. And I want to be able to say, if I can say nothing else, I want to be able to say at the end of my life, I have kept the faith.
Amen.
I have finished the race the Lord planned for me. Throughout 2 Timothy, the Apostle Paul has been exhorting Timothy to stay faithful to the gospel, to endure to the end. And you go back and you look in chapter 1, verse 15, you see that many people were turning against the Apostle Paul. You go to chapter 2, verses 17 and 18 that we will look at next week, and you'll see that some had even abandoned the truth of the gospel. So Paul wrote to encourage Timothy to endure everything for the sake of the gospel. So in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 13, the Apostle Paul reminded Timothy, and he reminds us how to endure to the end. How to endure to the end. And in verse 8, we see this point: to endure, remember the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 8 as I read it. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel. Now, Jesus Christ is central to our faith. So why would Paul write to Timothy and say, and ask the question, remember Jesus Christ? Now, in this verse, the Apostle Paul gives us some clues. No one knows for sure why he did it, but there are some hints here as why he tells Timothy to remember Jesus. First, I want you to notice the order of the names. Here he wrote Jesus Christ. You say, well, what's so strange about that? In that what we call Jesus, we call him Jesus Christ. But here's the thing. In this letter, Paul refers to the Lord as Christ Jesus 10 times. This is the only time he refers to him as Jesus Christ. Now, it could have just been as simple as when he wrote it. He wrote Jesus Christ and wasn't thinking any different. It could have been that simple. Or there could be a deeper reason. For a moment, let's just assume there's a deeper reason. And let's think that maybe the reason why this is the only time he writes to the Lord as Jesus Christ, it could be that Paul is calling attention to the humanity of Jesus. He was born as the man Jesus, who suffered and died on the cross for our sins, who rose from the grave on the third day. Perhaps Paul wanted to remind Timothy of the great price that Jesus paid for our sins.
Amen.
Second, Paul writes that Timothy must remember that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. This is again, basic theology, isn't it? And he's reminding Timothy of this. Remember that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Now, here's something neat about this. The verb tense here means that he was raised from the dead in the past, and he continues forever to be the risen one. He never died again. Lazarus was raised from the dead, but Lazarus died again. Jesus was risen from the grave, and he is forever the risen one. The resurrection of Jesus is central to the gospel. In fact, it's because of the resurrection of Jesus that the gospel cannot be bound, it cannot be contained. And then we see that Paul writes that Jesus Christ is the offspring of David. Well, this phrase confirms that Jesus is the Messiah who was promised to be a descendant of David. Everything about Jesus' birth, everything about his life, everything about his death, everything about his resurrection was fulfillment of the Word of God.
Amen.
And then we see that Paul writes that this is the gospel of Jesus Christ as preached in my gospel. Now, when he says my gospel, he's not saying that it's his personally, he possesses it, that he invented the gospel. No, he's not saying anything like that. He's saying the gospel was entrusted to him to proclaim, to live out, to proclaim the truth of Jesus Christ. You see, the crucified, risen Lord is the heart of the gospel. So Paul was reminding Timothy, and he's reminding us that when we get weary, remember that the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that cannot be bound and it cannot be contained. In other words, we can endure anything. We can endure anything because the gospel will be proclaimed and it will transform lives. The gospel always is uncontainable. It always transforms lives. That leads us to verse 9. And here we see this point, to endure, remember the power of God's word. In verse 9, Paul writes, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal, but the word of God is not bound. The gospel was the reason Paul was suffering. The gospel was the reason that he was bound with chains as a criminal. And then Paul adds this note of victory, but the word of God is not bound.
Amen.
The apostle Paul was chained and a prisoner because he had been arrested on made-up charges by people who were enemies of the gospel. He was treated as a common criminal and chained up in a filthy dungeon. There was nothing fair about what happened to Paul. There was nothing just about how Paul was being treated. But notice in this letter and every other prison letter of Paul's, he never complains. He doesn't complain about being arrested. He doesn't complain about his situation. Paul rejoiced in the fact that no one could ever imprison the power of God's word. It is unbound. Now here's where this applies to you and I. Oftentimes God puts us in or allows us to be in difficult circumstances because he wants the power of the gospel to shine through us to the world so that our joy in him in the midst of circumstances would cause most people to complain. Paul is an excellent model here for how to handle suffering, and whether it's just or unjust, how to handle suffering, and that is focus on the Lord.
Amen.
Focus on the Lord. He focused on the Lord. He focused on the gospel. More than anything, Paul wanted the gospel proclaimed, and his attitude was, if him being imprisoned unjustly would help the proclamation of the gospel, then keep him in prison.
Amen.
He doesn't grumble. He doesn't complain. You see, if we grumble and complain, we're missing the opportunity for the gospel to shine through our life. But if through the pain of tears and suffering, the joy of the Lord shines through the power of the gospel that saved us, may transform others.
Amen.
See, if when we're suffering, whether it's something physical or whether it's whatever area it may be, or if we're being persecuted for our faith in some way, if all we do is complain, we're acting just like the world. But if we focus on Jesus and we understand that he's at work in the midst of this, and we understand that he's going to glorify himself through whatever we're going through, then there'll be something different about how we respond. And the world will take notice that we're not acting like they act. And we can say it's because of Jesus living within me. And in spite of everything, I may not be happy about my circumstances, but I have the joy of the Lord in my life. And there's a big difference between happiness and joy.
Amen.
Happiness is dependent upon our circumstances. If our circumstances are good, we're happy. If our circumstances are not good, we're not happy. But joy is constant. If we're on the mountaintop in good circumstances, we're joyful for that. But if we're in the valley of suffering in some way, we can be joyful there because we're not alone. The Lord's with us. And he's always with us and will never abandon us. You see, we can endure anything because the gospel is not bound. Think about this. We can endure anything because the gospel is not bound by our circumstances.
Amen.
In fact, when we're in times of difficulty and suffering, maybe that's the freest the gospel's ever been. Because then we have an opportunity to tell others why we do have joy in those tough circumstances. That leads us to verse 10 in this point. To endure, remember the sovereignty of God. It says, therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Think about this. Just as suffering and persecution cannot stop the word of God, it also cannot stop the work of God.
Amen.
It cannot stop the word of God. It cannot stop the work of God. Paul knew that no matter how much he suffered, God was still on the throne and God was still at work. Paul knew that no matter how bad his circumstances were, God was still on the throne, God was still at work, and his purpose would be fulfilled. Therefore, Paul says he was willing to endure everything because the work of the gospel could not be stopped. Why did Nero put Paul in prison? To stop the work of the gospel. Why did he kill so many Christians? To stop the work of the gospel. But somehow or another, in that nasty prison cell, that hole in the ground, Paul got a letter written and got a letter out. And now over 2,000 years later, we're reading this letter. We're studying this letter. And not just us, but people all over the world in varieties of languages have this letter, and it encourages them and it draws them to the gospel. Even when he was in that prison cell, the work of God would not be stopped. Paul wrote that he would endure everything for the sake of the elect. Well, who are the elect? The elect are those who are saved and those who will be saved by the proclamation of the gospel. In other words, he's willing to go to prison if it helps people get saved. He's willing to go to prison if it helps people become closer to the Lord. Now, think about this with me. We might expect Paul to say that he would endure everything for the sake of God, for the sake of the Lord. And there would be nothing wrong with that. But Paul knew that our love for God is measured by our love for people, saved and lost, and our desire to see the gospel proclaimed and people saved. Paul was encouraged, Paul was strengthened by the reality that his sufferings were and the sovereignty of God beneficial to others.
Amen.
You know, Paul was, he was quite a man. In one of his letters, he wrote this, he said, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Now some have speculated that, or kind of paraphrased that a little bit and embellished it a little bit, but I think there's something to it. They said it could have been that one day that some of the guards came to get Paul and said, Paul, we're going to execute you today. He said, that's fine. To die is Christ. I'll go be with him today. Well, they could see that didn't rattle him, so they came back a little later and said, Paul, we decided we're going to let you live today. And he said, that's fine, to live is gain. I'll continue to serve him. That was Paul's attitude until they executed him. You let me, you kill me, you execute me, I'll go to glory and be with the Lord. You let me live, I'm going to continue to serve him. I'm going to continue to minister in his name, and I'm going to continue to write letters to people to proclaim his name. You see, Paul's desire was for everyone to experience salvation in Jesus Christ. Paul wanted everyone not just to be saved, but to mature in Christ. And he wanted everyone to experience eternal glory in heaven with Christ. And he was willing to endure everything so that everyone within the sound of his voice and everyone within his influence would come to personally know Jesus Christ and have their lives transformed by the Lord.
Amen.
Now, make no mistake, Paul was not enjoying his current circumstances in that filthy, miserable prison. No one would. He was not enjoying it. The fact that he didn't talk about it, it was just not the, it was not his priority. But he wasn't enjoying it. But he was more than willing to endure it because he was confident that God was using it for the salvation of many people. He says, I'm willing to endure everything.
Amen.
Here's the question for you and I. What are we willing to endure for the sake of the gospel being proclaimed? What are we willing to endure so that others might be saved? My guess is we don't even want to endure giving up some comforts. And I'm speaking of myself as well. But we need to ask that question when we think about people like Paul who endured so much for the sake of the salvation of others. What are we willing to endure to see others saved? And that leads us to the last verses, verses 11 through 13. And we see this point here, to endure, remember the trustworthiness of God. Remember the trustworthiness of God. This is verses 11 through 13. Verse 11, we begin reading, the saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. And if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Now, most scholars believe that Paul is citing words here from a familiar hymn of that day. We don't have all the hymn, but these are great words here. But we do have enough of the hymn here to see that Paul is reminding Timothy that God's promises are trustworthy. If God promised it, it's going to happen.
Amen.
You see, the portion of the hymn we have here shares four conditional clauses. Each begins with, if we, and it is followed by the result. So let's look at each one for a few moments. In verse 11, we read where it says, if we have died with him, we will also live with him. This is the foundational promise of the gospel. If we surrender to Jesus Christ, if we die, therefore die to ourselves and receive his gift of eternal salvation, we will live with him forever.
Amen.
And there is nothing we can do to earn this gift. Not nothing, even Paul could have died a martyr's death, which he did. That didn't earn him his salvation. We can only receive this gift of eternal salvation by grace through faith. So when we surrender to Jesus as our Savior and Lord, we're dying to self, giving up what we want, and surrendering to Jesus and living for what he wants. If we've died with him, we will also live with him. Verse 12, we see if we endure, he will also reign with us. Now, enduring or being faithful to the Lord to the end of life on earth does not earn us salvation, but it is evidence of our salvation. If we endure to the end, we're giving evidence that we were saved. The promise is that enduring suffering for the Lord in this life will be rewarded in eternity. And while those who have rejected Christ, think about those who have persecuted Christians down through the ages and have rejected anything to do with Christ, they will suffer in hell for eternity. Those who belong to Christ, who endured to the end and gave evidence of their salvation, they will reign with him for eternity. Then we come to verse 12. He says, if we deny him, he will also deny us. You know, persecution has a way of separating genuine believers from non-believers. I've read story after story of in other parts of the world where when the church might be doing good, and then whoever, gangs or cartels or the government came in persecuting the church, and all of a sudden the church didn't have as many members. It has a way of separating genuine believers from non-believers. You see, those who deny Christ, they don't give up their salvation. They are revealing that they were never saved to begin with. Let me give you an example. Judas never knew Christ. He never had a saving relationship with Christ, and his betrayal of Christ revealed his lost condition. On the other hand, those who are truly saved, we need not worry. Sometimes somebody will ask me, I'm worried I'm going to deny Christ. If you're truly saved, you're going to be faithful to the end. You're going to endure to the end. And you don't need to worry about denying Christ and losing your salvation. Because we can't lose what we have. Once we are truly saved, our salvation is secure and can never be lost. In John chapter 10, verses 27 through 29, Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." He says, "I give them eternal life." It's a gift. We don't earn it. "And they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand." That's the eternal security there, isn't it? But it's not based on us. It's based on who Jesus is. We surrender to him, and we are his for all eternity. And then the last phrase. If we are faithless, boy, this is a great promise, isn't it? If we are faithless, or we could actually say when we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. While the Bible repeatedly calls for Christians to endure to the end and warns against denying Christ, true Christians can rest in the faithfulness of Christ. Because here's the truth. Every one of us have, and before we draw our last breath, every one of us will fail the Lord.
Amen.
But he will never fail us. Every one of us, at one point or another, will be weak in our faith. But he is always strong to carry us when we're weak.
Amen.
At some points, we will all get weary. This life will beat us down and we'll get weary, but he will faithfully carry us on. God is faithful, and he will never be unfaithful to us. That's why it says he cannot deny himself. His very character is one of faith and faithfulness, and he cannot do anything but be faithful to us. Let me use Judas as an example. Judas betrayed him. Some might think, well, Peter denied him. Yeah, Peter was saved, but he had a moment when he was unfaithful. That's the difference. And since he was saved and Jesus confronted him with it, he repented and he was restored. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful. To my God, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, our salvation and our maturing in Christ ultimately rest on God's faithfulness and grace, not on our perfection.
Amen.
If we stumble in our faith, God will not be unfaithful to us because his nature is faithfulness.
Amen.
Earlier in chapter 1 of 2 Timothy, verse 12, we looked at this verse a few weeks ago. Paul writes to Timothy, "I know whom I have believed, and I'm convinced that he is able to guard it until that day what has been entrusted to me."
Amen.
What an assurance. God is faithful. He is always faithful. But here's the question for you and I as we close this morning. Will we commit to be faithful to Him? Do we commit to endure and be faithful to Him to the very end of our life on this earth? Will we be faithful? He is always faithful. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness. Because there are times we're not faithful. There are times we're weak. There are times we may want to give up. There are times we get discouraged. But Father, you are so faithful. And you hold us up. You fill us with your presence and your power and your strength so that we can endure, so that we can be faithful to you. And Lord, I pray this morning that each of us will commit ourselves to you today, that we'll be faithful. We'll endure. Because Lord, you are worthy of, you're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hymn number 433, I Surrender All. As we sing this hymn this morning, pay attention to what you're singing. So often, if we're not careful, we sing these hymns we're so familiar to. If we're not careful, myself included, we just sing them and we don't think about what we're singing. Sing, look at these words this morning. And just sing it to the Lord. Commit yourself to the Lord this morning as you sing this.